Okay, we're good to go. Welcome to the February 6, 2017 School Committee meeting. I'll call the meeting to order at 6:02. Review and approve the minutes of January 9th.
So moved.
Discussion? I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
Financial warrants.
Okay, so tonight you signed five warrants. I'm on the wrong page. For $27,148.66. And I've got two issues that are of concern to me. We just hired a long-term sub that is going to exceed our budget by $7,200.
What piece is that on?
She's not here yet because she hasn't, this is the January report and she didn't start until Thursday, which was February 2nd. But if you look on page two, the function code 2305, teachers' classrooms. See right there, it says there's $19,011 available.
Yep.
Okay, so we're going to exceed that by $7,245.
Which classroom or teacher is going out?
Well, can't discuss personnel.
Okay.
What is it, $7,245? On page two, function code 2305. And then the second thing I had brought earlier to your attention was the transportation. Our homeless student is now relocated back to Greenfield, but I'm projecting a shortfall there of about $3,157. So total, we're going to have a shortfall of about $10,402.
Well, how long have we been transporting that?
Since October, November, December, 3 months. But we also, don't forget, did not increase our budget for our out-of-district tuition student. We remembered to increase the tuition, but we didn't budget for the transportation. So between the out-of-district student's transportation and our interim homeless transportation, we're going to be short about $3,157. So together, that's $10,402. Now, we did have a mid-year termination of an IA in school choice, which I think we'll be able to use some of those funds. And also looking at the sub line, depending on how our subs go this year, there could be some savings there as well.
The IA was being, you said, paid under school choice?
Correct.
So that, usually we don't like to touch school choice.
Correct.
So
what I would do, Mr. Skrzoski, is I'm going to keep on top of this, and I'm going to charge the payroll to the regular budget until we get to June, and I'm more certain that there are some savings in other lines. Then we'll do the final switching back and forth of the payroll and use school choice only as a last chance circumstance.
Okay. So we already know that we're going to be at least 10 grand behind the 8-ball. Mm-hmm. And I have noticed going through the expenditure statement, there are other places that we are starting to fall behind as well. So mm-hmm. I think that we need to be cautious in our spending.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
I think we'll do okay in our sub line in particular.
Yeah, the substitutes are on page two. It's under function code 2325, and through January we still have $15,000 left. And these are, you know, January, February, March are usually, you know, when our teachers happen to catch everything our students do.
So that's almost 75% of the sub budget is still there.
So that's why I'm saying I'm concerned, but I'm not ready. I don't think at this point we need to make any adjustments. We just want to keep looking at that and keep our eyes open.
And then we have to keep in mind that how our cafeteria is going too. And that's another.
Yes. So, nice segue. I gave you a report tonight for our operations to date through January.
I only gave you one part of the report. I did not give you the statistical data, because when I was doing the data, it's not coming out correctly. It's not, my full price meals aren't adding up correctly. And I need to talk to Ms. Zemnowski about how she's reporting the full price meals. And she is on vacation this week, so I wasn't able to contact her. So I will bring that piece in March. But right now, we're running a little behind. Our sales are down.
Year-round employee?
She is. She's a 12-month employee. Our sales are down about 4,000, but our costs are down, our 41. Our sales are down 4,100, and our sales are, our costs are down 4,000. So we're about $109 more in debt than we were at this point last year.
$109?
Mm-hmm, and 26 cents.
More than last year, but we're actually $4,086 short, mm-hmm. Right?
Correct. What right now we're 56,38.71. If you go see the FY 17.
I realize that column was over there. Usually the other way around.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Katie. Okay, so that's 15,000 that we're already in the hole that we know, right?
Well, we don't, we usually, you know, we usually, the beginning of the year startup, we buy a lot of goods and services, goods, not services, goods and supplies, and then that lasts us. So now we hopefully from this point on, we'll be not doing as much purchasing and pulling down on our inventory. So our second 5 months are usually better than our first.
I just wanted to hear that.
Yes.
I just want to know why we have a great month of October and every other one stinks for sales.
There was more days. There was more service days in October.
Yeah, but overall, student sales are down, which is not a good sign.
No. See, and that's where I think that that's where I have to talk to Ms. Zemnowski, because I think what she's doing is she's in my student sales each month. She's only counting paid, what was actually paid. And then see in other sources, in miscellaneous, that's what she calls her IOU column. So at, how could you have IOUs in September? So I'm thinking that my student sales are underreported and my IOUs could be a little overstated, because if she's counting, she got the money on September 15th for lunches she sold on September 9th. Mm-hmm. So I need to talk to her as to what those numbers actually are in those columns that she's reporting.
That's because a lot of money in IOUs. I mean,
yeah, but we're collecting it. That's the good part.
I'm just saying it's high. I mean, it's $400. You know, 580. You know, 450. 840. You know, 800. Is that what's left over every month? Somebody has paid, but is that the outstanding which is still owed to us in January is $793.25? That's still owed to us in IOUs?
That's what I don't know. That's what we collected in IOUs in January. So I don't know what we collected. This is what we collected.
What we collected.
Right. Well, no, I shouldn't even have to put collected on here.
Yeah.
Right.
Collected should only be for me when I'm balancing my cash receipts to the bank. This should be our total sales. And when I noticed this is when I'm using your analysis, Katie, that you gave us, and I'm doing it by month that way, and I'm using it for all the schools. Mm. So when I do the computation, my lunch price should come out to be $2.75 plus the 42 cents that I'm getting from the feds on my full price, and they're not. They're all over the place. They're up and they're down, and they're up and they're down. So there's something not being reported correctly in one of these lines, and that's what I have to pull apart. One of the other things that I did say in Deerfield is that I am going to have each food service director prepare a budget. We've never budgeted our school lunch program. And if we set some benchmarks and goals for break even, we'll know sooner when we're off track. Mm-hmm. And then if they have that information, they can correct it hopefully in the next month. So that is something we're going to be working on. And then the last part of my report tonight, I got, we received two transportation requests for student transportation that fall under your policy of 1.5 miles. And Mr. Gripko would like some type of approval that the committee is aware and is in also in approval to break the policy, to you know, to allow these children to ride, even though they're under the 1.5 mile policy.
What is our policy? I'm sorry.
1.5. You have to be further than 1.5 miles.
From the school to take the bus.
Mm-hmm. And have no sidewalks, which we don't have sidewalks anyway. So we know why the request is being made?
We don't.
So maybe we should find that out. Why?
They can fill out one of the new forms. So I'll make a, how about if we make a motion to have a new form drawn up for
request
to, for the under 1.5 mile transportation by Gripko bus, and the reason why, which I think you guys
already discussed,
it already. And
I'll create it, first draft, I'll send it to Patty to review.
And we'll leave it into Pete's hands after for a reason why. If Pete doesn't think there's a reason why, and then he can bring it back to the school committee at you know, on any given time.
Does it add any cost to the bus?
No.
No.
And it doesn't change the route.
Right.
It's so just setting a precedent.
Take a look at it. If it's reasonable, I think it's all right. Yeah.
I suggested to Patty that we include some language in the paperwork that says that the, you know, the school committee reserves the right to change it at any time, and if they want it again next year, they'll have to apply again, that sort of thing.
Do you have a grade requirement that you would like to see, that if once they, you know, that we would approve them for third grade and under, because that's our policy that someone has to receive them?
Follow that line of thinking, that I think we do have something that policy that riding bikes, you can start, what, third grade or something?
Third grade, yeah.
So maybe that would be the cutoff. That would be reasonable if you're, you know, up to third grade, and then, unless it's a really good reason, they should be walking.
Okay. I'll make that form and then I'll type that.
So we have a motion. Yep. We have a second.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor? Okay.
Thank you. That's all I have, unless anybody has any questions.
Thank you. Public comment? Videographer doesn't want to comment or
nothing?
Okay. So, moving on to unfinished business. Update on the tree damage plan.
So, I was able to work with Keith Barnwell on putting together a meeting for the school committee and the principal, myself, to go over the planning of the new, whatever we're going to do to replace it. The meeting is set for February 14th, a Tuesday morning, and it will be in this building, and I think we set it for 9?
8:30.
And so the discussion will be, what will we do and how will we do it, what funds are available, and where we'll go from there. But it'll be definitely a team decision as to what we'll do, what's the best for the school.
Is Keith the only one that's coming from the town?
No, I think you invited the town administrator.
Yeah, I was going to suggest that. Good.
And I'm not going to make it, but you don't need me there, right?
I did it on a Tuesday, hope, you know, just simply because I know that Bob's available. And
right, that's fine. I don't need to be there.
It's getting close to the time where we need to think of something, think of what we're doing. We really have a plan in place.
Yeah, so we're ready to go next time. Good.
And in that same vein, we did receive the repair bills for the lights that were damaged by the fire, and they are on their way to Mr. Barnwell as well.
Very good. All right. Moving right along. FY18 budget. Patty, I guess you've made the changes that we requested.
Mm-hmm. Lynn, did you want to say anything first?
No, I've been watching it, and, you know, I will point out that Pete and I did have some conversations, and really good conversations, just to ensure that we are doing due diligence and doing the best we can to tie up loose ends and make sure that we're presenting the best budget available.
I think what's going to help us overall, you know, part of our increases is the salaries for the school lunch at 1.88. That's going to help offset our year-end total with the lunches. That's always in a deficit, and I think this is going to help us a lot. You know, is it a perfect solution? But if one could be guaranteed to be paid out of the budget, and the other one, you know, if there's a shortfall, then, you know, we can always fall back to, you know, school choice to pick it up. But if we could take care of the salaries out of it, that should keep us, what's good, black or red?
Black.
Thank you. So it'll keep us in the black, maybe, with our school lunches and stuff, you know.
Okay, so I'll take you through the changes starting on page 1 of 22. On our student and staff data sheet, we entered the goals of the Whately Elementary School Improvement Plan. The data for the census, we know the kindergarten, we have 7 coming up from our preschool, and we have 3 additional applications of students that are not in preschool that have been taken out. So we're looking at 10 right now, Whately residents. So that would bring us to about 122. And again, some of those, none of those children have been identified as special education at this point. On the right side of the page, we have made the adjustment to the instructional assistants. We reduced by 1. And then looking at page 2 of 22.
Can I just ask a question? On the projected for next year, does that include the new kids that we just received of the 122?
Because I used the October 1st census.
Okay.
So we use that as our jumping off point.
Yes.
Yeah.
18 kids now.
Okay.
Does this include choice kids? Or just residents?
We haven't accepted choice kids for next year yet.
Right. Well, but kids that are already in.
So you're not projecting
those,
them.
Those who are already here.
But we haven't projected any new choice.
So we have 2 new kids. Will you be, make it instead of 122, be 124, correct?
Correct.
That's right.
Just on this.
And so it doesn't factor in what we also know about who's leaving for the school?
What did we decide to do about that, Patty? We don't normally, in the past, we haven't projected that because, you know, we don't, first of all, it doesn't happen
changes.
All that often
yeah.
where we know this early, but we do know that 2 kids are moving next year. Mm-hmm. And I don't know.
The numbers will stay probably the same. If 2 are leaving and 2 are new, then the 122 would be the same then, right, mm-hmm. basically?
As of right now, the numbers haven't changed. Okay. When you say 2 are new,
We just got 2 third graders, didn't we?
Right. You're thinking about the overall numbers. I'm just getting confused because we're talking about school choice. The 2 that are new are not school choice kids.
Right. I'm just talking about the projected 2018 as a total here of 122. If you add the 2 new people to that, it'd be 124. But if we lose 2 for next year, then be back to 122.
That's correct.
I know this is as October 1st. I'm just asking.
The only thing that I would point out is it's hard to do the comparison if the numbers above have choice in them and the bottom numbers below aren't complete for kindergarten, right? Because we don't know.
This is going to give you an idea of what you're going to approve for school choice when Pete makes his recommendation.
Katie, they're not complete for any grade.
Okay.
And what, because we've never projected, and if the school committee's desire is to project, but we don't usually think about that until our April meeting when I give you a sense of where we have openings and how many slots we have. And in the future, I don't know if it's wise or not. Budget's not, you know, my forte, but we don't normally project school choice kids for the upcoming year when we're building the budget. But the kids that are school choice that are already in the budget, they're our kids. And you're correct that that if we know that we may have a departure, mm-hmm. that we might want to consider that, whether you choose to put that in the numbers or not. is up to you. Sometimes people change their minds, but it's hard to say.
The 122 does include school choice kids for projected for next year.
That's right.
The ones that are currently here.
Yeah, the currently are here.
But it's not really an apples to apples comparison, the 129 to the 122, I guess is what I'm hearing.
Why is it?
We lose them out of sixth grade, and we don't know what's coming in on kindergarten.
So that's always going to be a little higher the current year.
Yeah, until next October 1st, when things should arrive.
So it's just a little hard for planning purposes, I think, to not have it more consistent. But I hear what you're saying.
We'd love to fill out that kindergarten class, but we don't know what will.
Well, what we did last year and what we'll do this year is, we'll advertise and we'll decide which grades we have the space in according to, our school committee again is the group that created the parameters for 18 to 20 per classroom is our goal at this point in time, so that we maintain class size, which quite frankly is one of the attractions for school choice, so there's a balance point there. And I will come back to you with recommendations. I can do that sooner than April if you'd like. I mean, that's usually done in April, but if you'd like to do it in March, happy to do that.
It's just helpful to know, I think, what's coming. It looks like you have 15 signed up for preschool already, is that?
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, is that an accurate as of?
Are they signed up, or that's our capacity?
No, that's, we've done very well attracting families, and that's our number.
Once the school committee made the decision to go full day, we had the Greenfield Recorder come in and meet with our early childhood.
Yeah, I saw that article.
And it was a wonderful article, but then the phone started ringing, and so we're thrilled. And again, we thank the school committee, because this is really where the hard work gets done, is when you get them in early, do the interventions early.
Would you like that projection in March? School choice?
Sure. Yeah. Just back up, Kitty. The number that you are seeing, that 15, that I budgeted
you
at capacity.
Know.
I don't know what the real numbers are, but that is capacity.
I'm going to check that.
And that's what our early childhood director asked me to budget capacity.
Okay. Although we didn't budget capacity for kindergarten. I guess that's sort of the,
because we know we have enrollments. We haven't,
It's just a little inconsistent.
Right.
They're also different in relative to the fact that pre-K is entirely a separate program, separate budget, and kindergarten begins public school, sort of de facto public school and school choice, et cetera. But I am pretty sure that we have 15 registrations.
That's great.
That's
last
awesome.
Time I talked to Kim.
I know two of the twins that are in there, they love the idea of going full-time. He said to me, it's not great on my pocketbook, but he says, I'd rather have my kid in school all day long, and they were really happy that we went to full day, so.
Yeah, I mean, I love having this information. I think it's really, really helpful to have, so just want to make sure we're understanding what it's telling.
Sure.
Okay, so page 2 of 22 is our summary of changes. And under salary related, we have collective bargaining steps at 15,784. The 2.5 negotiated, the 2.5% increase that was negotiated totals $19,220. I wanted to bring to your attention that in this last contract, a new column was added, and that's adding $2,113 to our budget. We have three teachers in the building who qualify for the new M45 CAGs. The collective bargaining also increased the lead teacher stipend from $400 to $1,500, so we had to increase by $1,100. We're putting in here a modest increase for our non-unions, which you will vote at another point in the year, $1,160. I added the 1.5 FTEs for the school lunch that would add $30,068. And we decreased one instructional assistant for $23,789. So our total salary related increases total $45,656. We have some central office, some other operational increase. The central office percentage increased for Whately, and the cost for central office also increased. As I previously explained, we lost some grant funding for some of our directors, so we brought those salaries over. There was also some savings for closing 219 Christian Lane as well, and that is the net effect. The school committee expenses are increasing $1,150. Part of that, as I previously explained, was the unbudgeted dues to the collaborative, and also we're doing a new three-year contract with our attorneys. Principal office expense, $4,920. That was a request from Mr. Christofouli. We looked at that the other day. Was it advertising, Pete?
Advertising in particular.
Yes. The cost of print ads are really going up.
Which?
$4,900.
Let me just pull this up.
I believe 2 years ago we had a number that was more in line with what advertising is costing. We decreased it as we were trying to help out the budget, and then when we have had to advertise, we ended up going over that budget last year. So we increased it again, but it may be money that...
If that line is up 49 and it's just advertising, I think that's way out of whack.
Let me just take a peek.
Do we anticipate advertising a lot next year?
No, we don't.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's the copier, $3,500 for the copier.
Well, we did increase advertising too.
We increased advertising by $1,000. And the copier lease for $3,500. And we added postage as well for $420 because we spend it, but we've never budgeted for it.
Part of the office supplies, right? You usually, the postage?
There's a separate line item. We have supplies and materials, and then we have postage.
Okay.
Are the leases centrally managed for the copiers, or is that...
Centrally managed, huh? What do you mean?
Like the IT department does the copiers?
Scott Paul and I just started talking about that because every school has different types of copiers, and mm-hmm. to make it easier on IT. But the problem is we have to look into 30B. If we're saying we're going to go with a Kyocera, you're not supposed to name a brand for 30B.
Oh.
So Scott and I have to dig around on this a little bit more, but right now, no, they're not. Each school
has its own lease? Like,
yes.
You have a lease and Conway has a lease?
Absolutely, yes.
So you don't have a group lease that might lower the cost?
No. Textbook expense, this is something we decreased last year, and we find that we are still spending it, so we are asking for the money back at $3,405. Our technology software is a net increase of $4,516. These are softwares, again, our IT director spent his first time here doing a hardware inventory, and last year he focused on softwares. So these are not new softwares, these are softwares that everyone has been using, and we're just budgeting for them properly. Our transportation increase will be $476. And building security and inspections is a new line that we have been tracking. This money has previously been in our repairs and maintenance line. And our repairs and maintenance line is maxed out at $24,000. So if we don't pull out the 14, then we only have less than $10,000 for the year to maintain the building. So we're asking to pull out the building inspections and create this new line so that we actually do have $24,000 to do. And then if you remember correctly, so that brings us down to $9,000. And then I think we budgeted $2,000 for the roof inspection every year. So that brings us down to $7,000 to maintain the building.
So you're really asking for more money to do the maintenance of the building.
We're asking for the
depends how you look at it.
The security of the building. These are our
inspections
and security.
But you're saying you're taking that out of maintenance right now.
Correct. So there's really no money left to maintain.
Right. So you need money to maintain because you would pay these probably normally anyway.
That's correct. From the 24.
There's that much in there's 14,000 in inspections.
Yes. Hang on a second. Let me go down to that. That's 14,207 is exactly what we spent in FY 2016. So that's our pest control plan. That is the fire alarm monitoring. It's the sprinklers. It's the what do you call those? Fire extinguishers.
Boiler inspection.
I think we signed something for inspection. There was something, one inspection in that packet tonight. I remember signing that one through.
Is that another thing that is different for each school? Or?
Well, we, the Franklin County, thank you. I don't know where, I can't speak tonight. We are going out, as we did previously, on a joint bid for the fire.
Uh-huh.
So that has saved us some money because we're going out with most of the schools in Franklin County.
Uh-huh. But otherwise, Conway does their own.
Right now, everybody's on the same contract except for Whately.
Except for Whately. Mm-hmm. Is there any value in us looking at the contract?
Well, we are bidding it this time with Whately.
That's just fire.
Extinguishers.
That's not a biggie.
It's $1,800.
Yeah, well, it's not $14.
I'll break it down. I'll get the.
The software costs, are those one time or are those annual?
They're annual
licenses,
renewals.
So those are annual. Mm-hmm.
And those are basically programs for different teachers and different classrooms. Mm-hmm.
Subscriptions to software.
I think I signed some of those tonight. There's different names of different.
And then we have two decreases. We had budgeted last year for retirement buyback. We can decrease that line by $10,349. And the out-of-district tuitions, our student is in sixth grade and will be moving on to Frontier, so we can reduce that by $27, which brings a net change of $46,802 or 2.93%. from fiscal year 17 for a total budget of $1,646,256.
Well, you know, when you look at the long and the short of this, I mean, the salaries are $45,600 plus, and the net gain is $46,802.
Right.
I mean,
we basically balanced out our operational increases.
You know, so we moved figures around, but we're pretty much locked in. I mean,
those are all this contract, a lot of them, right? The big numbers.
I mean, the contract's driving this whole thing, and you take the contract out.
In salaries too,
I don't even think you're up a percent.
Mm-hmm.
The school lunch salaries are $30,000.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
We weren't in there before. That'll help the school.
So, you know, I think
that's reasonable.
I think you've done a pretty good job here,
yeah.
Keeping this budget down. And I think that, you know, we have a hearing in March. I would think we should just sit on this budget, move it forward into that hearing. Let me hear something.
Have the townspeople got the new version 2 yet?
No, I was waiting for you to see it before, and if with your approval, if you're comfortable with this, I would send it to Mr. Domino tomorrow.
I didn't hear what you said, Bob.
Sorry. Mm-hmm. Has the townspeople got the new version 2 yet?
Oh, you mean the town official?
Yeah,
financial.
And I said, no, I hadn't sent it, but if you're comfortable
Here's
with this tonight,
copy.
I'd send it to him electronically.
How do you guys feel about moving this on?
Well, the next meeting we vote on it, right?
Well, we have a hearing, then we vote a budget.
I mean, I think for this year it looks good. I think that I'm concerned more of what's going to happen in future years, you know, with the school choice monies and the balance between the town and the school choice. But that's not really for this budget. I think this is good.
How's Frontier looking for Whately's assessment?
That's going to be presented tomorrow evening.
Is it down?
Your percentage is down from 12.6% to 11.9%. And then right now the budget that the school committee has looked at preliminarily is a 3% increase.
Okay, about 3. I mean, how are we looking at?
Well, then I have to pull out how much your town, your minimum required contribution is, and that's what I'm working on right now.
Okay.
So that will be presented.
I'm just trying to look at the big picture, mm-hmm. how the town's going to mm-hmm. stack up. You know, and Frontier comes in low, and we're pretty low. I think we should be in good shape. But if Frontier comes in with a real high amount, then, you know, that sometimes affects the elementary, because the town has greater control over the elementary than the frontier.
Other towns, we're in really good shape versus some of the other towns. Some of the other towns.
In Frontier?
I'm talking about Sunderland's elementary, they're.
Yeah, where they have eight, I saw or something.
So we're blessed.
How big is the Frontier budget? Like, is 3% comparable to the 3% of our budget, or is it?
No, it's $10 million.
$10 million. It's a lot bigger dollars.
So you are comfortable with me sending this to Mr. Diamond?
I think it's.
Yeah, I could, yeah, let Tom take a look at it. Anything anybody wants to add?
The only thought I had is the preschool. I know that we just left everything the same here, and I know you looked at, you did like a P&L, preliminary P&L for the preschool. It seems like in future years, we may have some capacity from the preschool.
Yes.
Alleviate the budget a little bit.
Right.
I don't want to build that in now, but.
Nor do I, I want to play it safe.
It seems like we could potentially, if it does support itself.
So you'd establish.
We could move some expenses maybe.
A revolving fund for the preschool?
There already is one, Mr. Straske, because we already have it, everyone that comes pays tuition, so it's already established. And we pay $17,000 of our early childhood teacher right now, that's the only thing. So I think when we came and presented to you, I wanted to leave that flat for right now.
Oh, I agree with that.
And make the adjustments, because I think last time we were so involved with the numbers, we made a decision to shut down the program before we gave it a chance to really get up and fly.
But next year, we'll want to track that.
Absolutely, it'll be there. And I'll bring it to you in the fall, too, when we have the enrollments and the projected costs and the projected tuitions. So we can look at that in the fall.
And then after school, I was wondering, is that not represented here?
The after school time program? No, that's totally a separate animal.
So we don't have to.
It's not in our budget.
It's not in our budget.
Totally self-supporting program.
Okay, well, good.
Yeah, thank you.
Good work.
You need to vote on it?
No.
So next.
We really don't vote on the budget until we have the public hearing, because we want input from the public. They came in with something that was earth-shattering that would affect us. And, you know, as far as our vote goes, whatever we vote moves forward to the town. We can always lower on town meeting floor, but we can't increase it. So that's what we have to keep in mind, so something earth-shattering happened. Yes, we want to lower it. But, you know, we don't want to go too far, because if you have to go up, you're locked in once you give it to the town.
Usually they want us to come to the finance committee and to the select board.
You already have notice of that for Whately?
Be nice if they just show up to our meeting and had any questions.
Well, sometimes they don't even call us, huh?
Most of the time.
There's been years when.
Yeah, but lately they, I think lately they have.
We didn't get called in last year, did we?
Yes, we did.
Last year and the year before, maybe, but twice, if I'm not mistaken.
You know, I mean, it depends what it looks like, but I think this is really reasonable, so, you know, we may not get called.
When I send it to Brian tomorrow, I'll ask him if there is a request for us to appear to support our budget, and I will let you guys know when they set an appointment.
Good. All right, I guess we're ready to move on. Have no new business, so I have nothing to report, and do you have anything, Katie?
I attended a collaborative meeting last week or the week before, and there was a lot of discussion about how the collaborative might be more. They talked a lot about the services of the collaborative and how the professional development is trailing off, and that people aren't really using the professional development as much. And there was a variety of reasons, but they were looking for feedback on what would be helpful for the schools, potentially. So I just throw that out there, if people have ideas of what other services they might be providing that could be helpful to our school, we should open up.
Okay, good. Bob, you have anything? All right, principal's report.
All right, so I will do what I normally do. I'm not going to read everything on that page to you, because I know you can read it for yourself, but I did want to say that Last time I was with you, I presented a few things that were happening in the world of safety. And this year, you've gotten building updates as well from both Bob Lesko and I. And so tonight, I wanted to focus a little on social emotional learning piece that we do at our building. I started with, I actually borrowed that first paragraph I borrowed from our curriculum coordinator, Louise Law, who sent, she's in the process of working with our teachers. The Massachusetts frameworks are changing yet again, and the teachers are working with Louise to review the frameworks and see, you know, what, how they feel about it and how they're going to incorporate them into what we do. But she sent this email, and I thought it was interesting because they've added this guiding principle 9, and if you take a moment to just look at that, it talks about the importance of social emotional learning in the English language arts curriculum. Now, we do a lot of things here for social emotional learning, and I put some things in front of you tonight. As you know, we rely primarily on the second step curriculum and deliver lessons in class on social emotional learning. And the second step curriculum also includes an anti-bullying component. And the phrase or the quote that I borrowed from the frameworks talks about how even in the English language arts curriculum, that students will learn social-emotional skills through the text they encounter. When they see characters in stories, they recognize aspects of themselves in the text, things like self-awareness, self-management, social awareness, responsible decision-making, etc. So I just wanted to use that as a jumping-off point and then to bring to your attention this month the things that we're doing. And so those bullets at the bottom give you a sense of some of the things that we're rolling out this spring, not only for staff and students, but beginning on Friday, or on Monday the 13th, Dr. Birch, our new school psychologist and counselor, is presenting a workshop called Learn Skills to Help Your Child Thrive in Life, and that's all about social-emotional skills, and we are just starting to promote that. We sent an email home, and we've made these nice flyers that are in front of you, and we're going to continue to promote that and hopefully get the parents out for that training. We're also planning on doing a couple of trainings on anxiety in children. That's a little closer to the bottom of the list. Second step has student surveys. I put those in front of you as well. You can see that they are clearly made for the age level of the students. The first one is thumbs up, thumbs even, thumbs down. So the way kids will answer. And then there's a third and fourth grade one. And of course, the most involved one is for the oldest kids. And for staff, teachers have asked for more support and training around classroom discipline. And again, we're taking that directly from the responsive classroom in this case, which is the other primary approach to social emotional learning that we use in our school. So we are going to have on the next two early release Fridays that are building based, and I think I put the dates there, we are going to have another 2 days of support and training for staff around classroom discipline. Actually, the teachers, I'm going to probably release them from their classrooms for an hour and a half at some point in the next month or two, so we can work directly with them. But the two afternoon all-staff trainings will be approaches to lunch, playground, and hallways, as you might imagine. That's where we have most of our concerns when kids have conflicts. So we really want to get focused on some of that and refresh ourselves around, you know, how we manage and the common language that we use and the common approach. Because that's how social-emotional learning is done best, when there's consistency. And that's how our work is done best, when we're all consistent, use the same language, and approach things in a similar fashion. So I thought I'd lay it out in front of you tonight and let you think about it. Of course, if you have questions now, I'll entertain them. But always feel free to bring it back to the next meeting, because sometimes it's just not enough time here tonight for you to read what I put in front of you and to digest it all. So just wanted to give you a sense of what was happening there in my principal's review.
Very good. Thank you, Pete. Anybody have questions for Pete? If not, moving along. Superintendent's report.
Thank you. I have to say, I just need to add that I think it's very telling when the state curriculum frameworks start including social emotional learning in our English language arts classes, how to intertwine the problem solving that the characters and our stories go through so that the children can identify with them as they approach issues in their own lives. So it's quite the thing across the state. Every time I get an email or something about what's happening in the state, or for instance last summer when I went to the superintendent's conference, it's pretty much about social emotional learning. the school board commit, the school board conference that we had for school committee members, social emotional learning. Because we're seeing so many more kids come in today, in all schools, everywhere, not just in our district and in our schools, but they don't have the coping skills. They don't have those, boundaries on what's acceptable to how to problem solve or how to behave or how to react. And it's a big job. It's a big job in all the schools. So it's clearly it's showing up everywhere. So my superintendent's message tonight is I wrote in my superintendent's message. Of course, every month I put a message online, and this month's message was about some of the unease that families in our area are going through with the ban on immigration. It's off now, but it could go back on, and it's this, it's that, and it's in legal limbo. We don't really know, but the superintendents across this part of Western Massachusetts have been going back and forth and having conference calls and talking, and so what I did was I took an excerpt from the superintendent of Amherst, but also the superintendent of Northampton. They, you know, crafted statements, and while I took their statement, it just says that as public officials, it's our duty, you know, to use legal and moral authority to protect all the members of our community, no matter what. Our pre-K-12 schools will continue to enroll and serve every child living within our district who chooses to attend our schools without regard to his or her immigration standards or status. So I continue by saying we're fortunate to be living so close to several colleges and universities where we can benefit from a wide range of perspectives, experiences, and background that are drawn to this area. At Frontier Regional and Union 38 schools, we believe in diversity, and our students and staff make our schools richer and stronger while preparing our children to develop the skills needed to live and work in a global marketplace. So I wanted to let you know that this is out there. People are concerned. This is also something that was kind of spearheaded by the collaborative, and all the superintendents got in on it. We don't want people to be worried that we're going to say your student can't come here because you're an immigrant or, you know, where's your green card or whatever. So we're watching closely what's going to happen, but we do want to reassure our families.
Do we have any families that are in
this?
Do we know?
In this particular building, not that I'm...
Or staff? Or
in other buildings, yes. Mm-hmm. This building?
I don't think so. Not directly. I mean, there could be things I don't know about people's families, of course, but when I think about the student population, I don't know. I know we have, we have some families whose parents are, you know, work on our local farms, and I'm not aware of exactly what their status is.
It's not something we track, anyway.
In Power School, we put in the ethnicity, When children register for the first time in any school, they have to, you know, birth certificate, parents' license. I mean, we really do figure out, you know, who they are and where they came from. But we also have a law called McKay-Vinto for homeless students. And if they're somehow staying within our jurisdiction, somewhere in our towns, whatever town that might be, if it's our town, we... are bound by law, regardless, to take them in, not wait. We don't wait for medical records, we don't wait for any, that they come into our school, and they're welcome into our school, regardless of where their parents may have come from or what they're doing, it's the law. Mm-hmm. So the children are protected. It's really all about the children. Mm-hmm. Fortunately, Whately is such a welcoming place anyway, it probably would never impact anyone, because we are such a welcoming school here. Kids are lucky to be here. So that's.
Can I ask a more of a logistics question? Your message that gets posted every month, people know that there's that message getting posted every month, or can we send it out to people? Because I don't think people know.
I got some response today. Actually, I got kudos today. Someday, you know, it's not always going
to
happen.
But it's up to people to go and look at it. It's not something that gets mailed out.
Does it track how many views it has? Do we know?
I'm not sure about that, but people respond to me. And I know at one time I put one on when I first started here in August, mm-hmm. and I said, I'll be here and here. If you know, and then people were like, oh, well, wait a minute, that time is this time, and how could she be here and there? We had two ice cream socials on one night. I think people read it.
Well, I might just encourage to think about if there's a way to email it out to parents. I don't think parents necessarily would go and look at that.
Well, that's certainly something that, yes, because I'm already crafting.
Because you're doing it. I didn't even know you were doing a monthly message.
Yeah, well, last month we talked, and I bring it to the school committee. So last month we talked about all the stuff that goes into deciding whether it's a delay or cancellation. Right?
Will you be using that tonight?
I was going to say that.
I know.
What are you thinking?
I have the seniors come in today and say, now, Dr. Carey, don't worry if you have to call the school off tomorrow. It will not be a problem. It'll give us more time to do our homework. And I'm sure, well, if you're using your time wisely, I'm glad that you know. But I do think that that's a really good suggestion. I am crafting next month already because it will be about budget and trying to make the best decisions with that constant balancing between what the taxpayers can you know, bear and what we need to survive. So,
yeah, I think it would be great to push that message out more if you can.
Yeah, I believe I can. So, thank you. I'll figure out a way to do it. Yeah, thanks. Thank you. Oh, let me get my notes. Wait a minute. Wait before you do anything. Yeeks. Okay. That's my message.
Go Patriots.
Hey, all set?
Thank you. I am done. Thanks,
wow,
Tom.
Waiting, Bob.
Go Patriots.
Go Patriots.
Yeah.
All right.
Make a motion to adjourn at whatever time.
Yes. 56 seconds. You have a second? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.